तेरा मन जाए वहां। Each and every entity of mysterious and miraculous creation of God. We see lot of homogeneity, heterogeneity, disparity and parity, integrity and repulsion, federal work, collective work, composite work, parallel work, contrary work. Various these experiences we are seeing in ecology. And for each and every entity, the characteristic, the physical as well as chemical as well as ecological, what are these characteristics to do with the nature, the structure and function of each and every entity and how they are distinct. Each and every, what we call vastu, swarupa, swabhava, guna, vikara, vibhava. Each and every entity, its structure, its functional nature, its federal nature, its transformation nature, its collective nature, its destination and recycling, all of these things are based on a phenomenon which is scientifically, rationally, philosophically known as selection. And there are two types of selection. One is natural selection and artificial selection. Natural selection is what we call in religion and philosophy a divine selection or a divine will. And in general science or rational, it is considered to be natural selectivity, which is not enforced by a third element. And this natural selection, whatever that is there at the time of the crude creation as well as the expansion of the cosmos, the second expansion is known as civilization. The first expansion is the cosmic expansion, in which various life forces, life structures, as well as their abodes and substratums have been evolved. And they have been processed over several millennia. The second type of expansion, I told civilization, the civilization has contributed much for artificial selection. Why it is like that? If it is having a flaw, why can't we remove that? If it is having a character, why can't we identify and make it more productive to us? If something is not responding to this, why can't we make it respond? So this type of both crooked as well as clairvoyant, that which is time-oriented, that which crosses the barriers of needs of present with the futuristic, that which restores and assures us long-term benefit, cyclic benefit, assured benefit, unalloyed benefit. So this type of artificial selection that has just sprung from the curiosity, which is of two types. One is a clairvoyant or perspicacious curiosity. Second is a crooked or collapsed curiosity by which we have tried to implant as well as implement lot of possibilities against the rules of nature and also under the latent rules of nature. There are two things. If there is pattern and if we weave and make it in the form of a cloth, it is not against nature. It is a process by which we make things in a desirable form in which it is permissible even by that latent issue of the nature itself. So, what all we are doing by means of our innovative measures, by means of our additive measures, they fall under two more categories. Apart from these two curiosities, they fall under two more categories. One is that which is silently sanctioned by the nature itself. How we can identify the silent sanction as well as the silent repudiation? We can identify very easily by means of its immediate, mediate or remote impacts on the ecological and biological factors. We can understand whether it has been sanctioned or de-sanctioned. So this type of sanction is understood by people and it is known as productive use of science or efficacious use of science or salubrious use of the science for the welfare of the society or the total ecological system. And it deals with different steps. One is identification, and second is use, third thing is multiple utility, fourth thing is upgradation, fifth thing is multiplicity or multiplication, sixth thing is control, seventh thing is extirpation, eighth thing is customization. These are all the eight characters of artificial selection in which we identify things, we upgrade things, we customize things, we multiply things, and we control few things, and we extirpate some unwanted or pernicious factors. These are all the limbs of artificial selection. On the basis of which, the industry of vegetation, that has also seen these various stages or phases of transition and evolution. That which is there in the crude form, what we call terminologically indigence. They start with indigence, which is a natural, unprocessed wild product, which has resulted in now we are having cultigens and cultivars. That which is processed by means of a human intellect, that which is by the architectonic evolution for a human infusion, and that which has been specifically processed and the variety has been fixed with a nomenclature system, that is what we call cultivar. So that indigen has developed into cultigen and cultivar now. And depending upon the need of the growing population, number one. Number two, need of the non-conducive ecological factors which are governing as a substratum for development of the industry. There must be some sort of conducive munificence that is showered by the nature itself. Then if we are growing, as well as the factors which are substantially contributing for the development of the consumers are growing, the consumption will also grow. So the productive elements and also the conducive elements, they must also simultaneously parallelly grow. But the factors that are determining the multiplicity or multiple or polylevel productivity catering to the need and expansion, further expansion for the society, they are just subjected to declination. So we have to get these things for three reasons: due to the expansion of the population, as well as contraction of the natural conducive munificent shower towards the hyper productivity of the essential crops. For three reasons, it is behaved and believed that artificial selection and its intrusions is more essential and indispensable at this era. And number one, to have more productivity, that is known as yield or munificence. Number two, to develop more resistance to fight against the factors. There is eco-resistance and bio-resistance. Eco-resistance deals with temperature and other factors. Bio-resistance deals with pests and other unwanted intrusions. So these resistance should be developed. And third thing is amplitude or processing promptitude. So apart from getting into more yield, which is known as munificence, and more power to withstand the non-conducive as well as colliding factors to its solubility, longevity and productivity, that is resistance, and number three, it is processing promptitude. So to fix a limited time frame for more productivity with more rich in nutrition as well as the withstanding potency or resistance to go against the non-conducive factors that are biologically and ecologically presented inside that. So this has resulted in two major systems of thought. One is known as the school of domestication, second is known as school of acclimatization. The school of domestication is that which is grown in a specified unorganized atmosphere to bring the same thing. What is the difference between a plant and the crop? We used to say in Sanskrit, Veshaja, Aushadha, Sthavara, Virudha. They appear to be synonymous, but they are different. That which is just a member of the botanical kingdom is known as Sthavara. And that which is having some divinity is known as Virudha. That which is having medical value is known as Veshaja. That which is having supportive value, that is Poshana, by which it grows us, that is known as Aushadha. Aushadha, Bheshaja, Virudha and Sthavara. Likewise, if it comes like that, it may be a plant, just a general name. If you cultivate systematically, it becomes a crop. So it is a process by which they are domesticated, they are acclimatized. And that is what we call wild connectivity or wild crop relatives. For each and every crop that we are using now, there will be some, just as the Homo sapiens for the human race in the genesis process or the theory of evolution of Darwin, each and everybody, they will be having a parental species. Likewise, there will be certainly a wild crop relative which has been accustomed, and by use of utility, they have been brought into domestication. Second thing is acclimatization. Acclimatization is altitude. Second thing is temperature. Third thing is soil type. Fourth thing is hydro, that is water requisition. Then photo, light requisition or sunlight requisition, whatever it may be. So all of these various things, they constitute the ecological factors. So we want some specific altitude. We want some particular soil type. We want some nutrient some nutritious content value specified. So